You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to read some letters and tune you in to some things that our listeners in their letters have brought to my attention. And then we're going to talk about a horror story. And then if there's time, we may read some more letters. So you don't want to miss one single moment of tonight's broadcast. Bill, I listen to your program on satellite. I recently heard you say you were on G2. According to the recent article in Satellite TV Guide dated June 16th through the 22nd, G2 was replaced by G6. G2 was at 74 degrees and is now G6 at 74 degrees west. I suppose it doesn't really matter, since if you program your receiver at 74 degrees west, you will get the G2 G6 satellite. New people to satellite won't be able to figure out where you are in the sky because the satellite guides don't list G2. I might suggest you say you are on G2 G6 at 74 degrees west, which might clear up the confusion. I normally do. I may have slipped the night that you were listening and just said G2, but I usually say Galaxy 6. And I usually explain to the listening audience that it's either on their receiver as G2 or G6. Just to clear up the confusion that may exist, I thought I'd read that letter to all of you. And he sends a little part of the satellite guide. And it says, as for G6, that satellite moved last year to replace the old G2 at 74 degrees west longitude. That's why you see programming listed on G6 when you recall G2. You should be able to erase G2 and program G6. Now, if you're out there listening on shortwave, ladies and gentlemen, and you have a satellite receiving system, all you have to do is go to G2 or G6, whichever one your satellite is programmed for at 74 degrees west longitude. That's G2 or G6. Go to channel 14, or what some people call transponder 14. Most people call it channel 14. And then manually change the audio to 7.56, and you can listen to the Hour of the Time in high fidelity, pure, crystal clear sound, just as if I were sitting on your couch talking to you. Only after going through all this electronic processing, you would not recognize my voice if I was really sitting in your home talking to you. This from James. James is one of the premier, in fact, it is the premier publications that monitor the military services of the world, their weaponry, their aircraft, their armor, their training, and all of that kind of stuff. According to James, and this was March 6, 96, Vietnam has been training Cuban commandos for limited attacks in the United States if Washington invades Cuba, James Defense Weekly reported. Havana's strategy in pursuing such training is to attack the staging and supply areas for United States forces preparing to invade Cuba. The political objective would be to bring the reality of warfare to the American people and so exert domestic pressure on Washington. Might work. And this from the Boston Herald. The Boston Herald, June 28, 1996. Confirms everything that I've been telling you. Here's a story. FBI files. Scope out Hollywood stars. Walt Disney. It says here, he was an FBI snoop on his colleagues in Hollywood. You heard it first here on the Hour of the Time 4 years ago, ladies and gentlemen. One file recommending his recruitment as an FBI source says it is believed that he can be of valuable assistance to the office. Many others refer to him afterward as an approved SAC contact. SAC stands for Special Agent in Charge. Not only was Disney an FBI informant and an FBI operative, but Disney was also an operative for the intelligence community and also helped NASA making the phony pictures of the moon that you all thought were real for so many years. Don't feel bad. I did too for a while. Also, one night I was talking about a videotape that shows the reality of what our forces did in Panama, and I couldn't remember the name of it. One of my station chiefs wrote in to tell me that the name of it is Panama Deception. You may be able to find it in some large public libraries. The name of the videotape is Panama Deception. Okay. And what else here? I guess that's about it. And here's a note. Here's a note, ladies and gentlemen, on Phil and Marlene Marsh, who used to run the Pilot Connection, and then later they changed the name to something else. I forget what it was. And they have been found guilty. And I'm not sure what they've been found guilty of. They were convicted last year of 72 counts of mail fraud, tax evasion, and conspiracy to defraud the IRS. Trial in 1993 had ended in a hung jury. They were just found guilty not too long ago. I announced that over the air. And they were going to appeal. U.S. District Judge Von Walker sentenced 72-year-old Philip Marsh to 17 and a half years in prison. And Marsh's wife, Marlene, who is 60 years old, to 14 years in prison. They were right about the IRS, ladies and gentlemen, but they just didn't know how to argue their case. And many of us tried to tell them that they didn't know how to argue their case, and they would not listen. And so now they're in jail. It's still under appeal, as far as I understand, so they may win out in the long run. And now, for the horror story. Yeah! July 17, 1996, programming was interrupted, reporting that there had been a plane crash off Mauritius Inlet, Long Island. Takeoff from Kennedy was at 8:19 p.m., and it disappeared from radar at 8:48 p.m. The aircraft was a TWA 747 Flight 800. What I'm going to give you tonight is just a little bit of what we have already learned, ladies and gentlemen. And you don't have to make speculations when you have facts. We have tons of information pouring in from the East Coast with every mail pickup. And we are beginning to put together the truth of what happened to TWA Flight 800. We do not have to speculate. We do not even have to tell you anything. We don't have to guess. We don't have to draw conclusions. It will become evident to you very quickly. It always does when you are in possession of the facts and when you can filter through the bullshit. The truth stands out like a beacon in the night. Also on July 17, 1996, numerous eyewitnesses to the crash called in live to WNBC News TV. Some were on the beach, others were on boats, surfing or driving in their cars. Mrs. Saltzman had been out on the deck of her home overlooking the water. She stated that she had been watching the activities of a Black Hawk helicopter and a C-130 in the area. Apparently, flares were being fired. She then said that she saw a bright white light, a small flare-like red fireball, then a huge fireball falling like a sheet to the water. Then there were several explosions. A woman who identified herself as Anuziata Zahid had been out on a boat with her husband. She had been watching a small aircraft, and she referred to it as an aerolite or something similar. I wasn't sure if this was something like a glider craft or one of those planes run by remote control, as the name she gave to it was totally unfamiliar, unlike Cessna, Beechcraft, etc. She also described a bright white light, a small flash, and then a fireball. Many people compared it to the Challenger. All witnesses were agreed on a bright white light, then what they thought to be a flare, a small fireball, and then a large fireball. The plane was splitting apart, one piece going in one direction, then a larger piece going in another, falling to earth in a sheet of fire, causing about five explosions when it hit the water. Mr. Rosenblum stated that he lived in an apartment building approximately 10 miles away and that his building shook. Later, news reports showed the C-130 and a couple of crew members. The plane was apparently getting ready to take off again to help with the search. It was reported that they had dropped life rafts at the time of the explosion. I guess this must have led to the confusion on the part of other searchers, thinking that these rafts were TWA rafts and that maybe the people had warning enough to deploy these rafts and that maybe there were survivors. News reports then showed massive fires on the surface of the water, with C-130s dropping numerous flares over the area, assisting in rescue work. July 18, 1996, CBS Channel 2. The early news reported that the plane had been held up for an hour at the gate to fix an engine pressure gauge. Let me repeat that. July 18, 1996, CBS, that's the Communist Broadcasting System, Channel 2. The early news reported that the plane had been held up for an hour at the gate to fix an engine pressure gauge. No other mention of this was made on the days that followed, and no one has mentioned it since that one and one only announcement. 2:45 a.m. on Fox News. There was a report that WTSP of Tampa, Florida, had received a call. Mike Cavender, news director and vice president of WTSP, stated that the call was too brief to record and that the person identified himself as a jihad member and that this was the first of many. 9:30 a.m., Attorney General Janet Reno made a vague statement about supposed calls to a Tampa news station and the Justice Department from some groups taking credit for the crash. She did not name the groups. 10:30 a.m., the news reports that the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms is on its way to the scene. 10:40 a.m., Representative Charles Schumer appeared on Communist Broadcasting System announcing that he knew this would happen. Now remember, in a couple of issues of Veritas before, we called attention to the fact that Charles Schumer, when he did not get his way with the counterterrorism bill, made a statement on the floor of the House that if everyone knew what he knew, they would not have emasculated his counterterrorism bill. And here he says that this is what he knew would happen. So Charles Schumer has admitted that he knew this would happen in advance. He says he wanted more stringent controls in his anti-terrorist bill and that America needs to be made safe. I think America needs to be made safe from Mr. Charles Schumer, ladies and gentlemen. Marsha Kramer, another Communist Broadcasting Service news reporter, reported that Air National Guard members on board the C-130 reported something going up in the air towards the plane from ground level. There was also a call from a man reporting that he had watched a flash of bright white light for the largest time before the fireball. Let me give this to you one more time, ladies and gentlemen, because this is important. Marsha Kramer, Communist Broadcasting Service news reporter, reported that Air National Guard members on board the C-130 reported something going up in the air towards the plane from ground level. There was also a call from a man reporting that he had watched a flash of bright white light for the largest time before the fireball. At 1:15 p.m., Charles Schumer called in to the Communist Broadcasting Service, reporting that he had talked to the Federal Bureau of Investigation and that these claims were not credible. There was only a vague reference to the second call at Janet Reno's news conference in the morning as having been made to the Justice Department, but this has not been reported or elaborated upon since, nor has it been mentioned by anyone. On July 18th, Marsha Kramer of the Communist Broadcast Service reported that donor organs for transplants were on board and there were supplies of HIV blood and diplomatic pouches. There were no further reports on this. At 11:20 a.m., President Clinton referred to Oklahoma City, but urged people not to jump to conclusions. So far, only Charles Schumer has jumped to conclusions. In the meantime, the Communist Broadcast Service, the Allied Broadcasting Communists, the National Broadcasting Communists, and the Communist News Network continue to show the remains of the aircraft that was bombed over Scotland in Lockerbie. Whenever they talk about TWA Flight 800. At 4:15 p.m., the Communist Broadcasting Service again, Charles Schumer, stating that very sophisticated people had to be involved, that explosives could be in a very small package. The BATF, FBI, and the Federal Aviation Administration and the National Transportation Safety Board were on the scene. We got the distinct impression that a lot of bickering was going on behind the scenes as to jurisdiction. It was announced that a fund has already been set up for the Montoursville students. I'm not sure why. There's a report of a C-130 and Black Hawk helicopter on a training mission that was at the scene of the crash. Witnesses report flares from C-130s before the crash. It had been announced earlier that there would be a news conference at 5 p.m. on July 18th with the crew of the C-130. Checking all stations across the country, if the news conference took place, it was not reported by anyone. We called the United States Coast Guard, ladies and gentlemen, in New York and in New Jersey. We asked them for the records of the routine training flight of the Black Hawk helicopter and the C-130. We were assured that it was nothing but a routine training flight. yet we discovered through our informants within the Coast Guard and from other sources that no records exist of any routine training flight of a Black Hawk helicopter and a C-130 aircraft. When we pushed the Coast Guard to answer these questions, they hung up on us. Subsequent attempts to contact the Coast Guard and obtain answers concerning the records of the routine training flight have all resulted in instant hang-ups. At 2:30 p.m. July 18th, it was announced by some congressmen that the black box had been found. At 3:10 p.m., it was announced that the box had not been found. Several times on various newscasts, it was reported that no other aircraft were in the area at the time of the crash. Obviously, someone neglected to tell them that the C-130 and the Black Hawk and the small craft witnessed by the first call-in reports would certainly qualify as other aircraft. At 4:20 p.m., July 18th, CBS, W. Bacon of the Pentagon reports that there is an increased threat to all U.S. citizens. At 4:50 p.m., reports on the Olympics. The disaster of TWA Flight 800 was equated to terrorist attacks at the Olympics. Flashes were given of Oklahoma City and Lockerbie, Scotland, Flight 103. More security was called up. WABC Channel 7, Annunziata Zahid, the eyewitness, was on camera reporting that five explosions occurred as the aircraft hit the water. She had looked up and saw black smoke with a white cloud over it. This is the same woman who had reported seeing a small aircraft on earlier eyewitness call-ins. 7 p.m., Dan Rather, Communist Broadcasting Service News, National Guardsmen from the C-130 were on for about 15 seconds. They reported that they had spotted inflation devices on the water. This is very confusing, as it had been reported earlier that the C-130 is the aircraft that had dropped the flotation devices in the water. July 18th, Pablo Guzman, Channel 2, Communist Broadcast Service, reports that clothes were blown off many bodies, that there were chemical burns reported on bodies by the medical examiner's office, but no sign of explosive injuries. 15 to 20 bodies were examined at that time. Charles Welty, medical examiner, reports no shrapnel found in any of the bodies. At 8:25 p.m., Channel 2, Charles Schumer began speaking on the terrorism of Syria, Libya, and Iran. Mr. Schumer stated that even if it was an accident, we should still go ahead with all-out security measures. Boston Air Traffic reported an additional blip on the screen just prior to the crash. And I repeat, Boston Air Traffic at 8:25 p.m. on Channel 2 reported an additional blip on the screen just prior to the crash. To date, July 21st, there has been no in-depth reporting on military training missions taking place in a major air traffic corridor. Nobody except call-in witnesses have mentioned the Black Hawk helicopter. There are no reports on the other small aircraft that was sighted in the vicinity. July 21st, the Sunday edition of CBS, Communist Broadcasting Service. Marsha Kramer reports that serious consideration should be given to ground-to-air missile, as several eyewitnesses, including National Guard crew aboard the C-130, saw something shooting towards Flight 800. This program included the reporter Marsha Kramer, former New York City Police Commissioner Bratton, Richard Bouillet, expert on Mideastern affairs, and Ken Nolan, who was an aviation expert. It was discussed how suitcases going aboard planes are not x-rayed, though the technology exists. There are two CTX 5000s at Atlanta Airport. Ken Nolan remarked that citizens should be more concerned with safety than being on time. Commissioner Bratton spoke of the 2 hours it takes when flying El Al Airlines with numerous questions asked of passengers. If you trip up on questioning, they go to the next level. It was also stated that people should be charged more for all this security. The Constitution for the United States of America and the rights of the people against unreasonable search and seizure and to be secure in their person and in their property was, of course, never discussed. July 21st, Face the Nation. Vice President Al Gore was measured, evasive, and laborious in his answers. The commentator spoke of the ineptness of airline mechanics who on testing couldn't draw a rectangle, but with coaxing could draw a triangle. Through all of this, every politician and his brother were maneuvering for media coverage. Obviously, some tragedies are more politically correct than others. Relatives of victims have been given little information. It took some time for the manifest to be checked, with one evasive excuse after another being given. It's remarkable how quick the information on your credit card comes up, or an unpaid ticket if you're stopped by the police, but checking passengers' names in this instance was a monumental task. So while citizens are checked, fingerprinted, searched, questioned, and x-rayed, some dopey mechanic is attending to the maintenance of the plane with recycled parts from outside contract services and can't even draw a rectangle. Air traffic control systems, meantime, are so outdated that their equipment is still being run by vacuum tubes, with systems going out on a regular basis, leaving air traffic controllers with blank screens. It seems like the main agenda is not really protecting citizens, but controlling citizens. We get the feeling that traveling is going to get more and more under government control, with people being more and more harassed. And that person who was standing in front of you at the ticket counter, that's funny. He's not on the plane when it takes off. I wonder what happened to him. Meantime, politicians and corporate people will fly private jets and avoid all the scrutiny. Then there's ground-to-air missiles. What security protects a plane from these? How ironic that citizens may be shot down by one of our own or someone else's missiles. It seems that the Central Intelligence Agency is trying to buy back hundreds of surface-to-air Stinger missiles that it secretly gave to Afghan guerrillas. In March 1994, the Washington Post reported that the covert Central Intelligence Agency buyback was plagued with failures and wasted money. Congress has authorized $65 million in secret funds, $10 million more than a year earlier. Not too long ago, a man was making his way through Patriot groups and talking to Patriot leaders, offering to sell them an entire truckload of Stinger missiles. No one took him up on it. Everyone told him to hit the road, Jack, and don't let the door hit.